In the Masonic Club, right? Lovely. The Royal Masonic Hospital. It is... Oh, I gotta turn my phone back on. Hang on. Yeah. Engraved with the images of the AA trails. More especially the trowel. A few minutes. The gavel. Chalices. Key to the Grand Temple. Oh, we say had installed no glare glass. Which they didn't make, by the way. Few minutes before the tour begins. These open or unfold or something. Oh, okay. Are they dated?
1810.
Okay, so that one's 1810. These are all empty for now. There's one from circa 1800. And then nothing. All right. It's almost 11. 1800, 1834. These are awesome. Careful, careful. They're fragile and awesome. All right, I think we should go. That's a nice gavel. Where are we? Are we meeting? Are we meeting here?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, then we can continue to browse. John Manders. What is this for? $1761 Wedgwood and other potteries, centerware suit. Oh, okay. Display vases. Getting some shots here. Sorry about the angle of the video.
Hi, good morning to you all, and welcome to United Grand Lodge Freemasons Hall. My name is Stephen, I'll be taking you around on the tour today. By all means take photos, we'd love you to take photos, but please bear in mind we're strictly timed as far as these tours are concerned, so I won't be hanging around too long where you focus. Also, the other thing is, if you hear the fire alarm, follow me. I'll be the first one out the building, I can show you. Now, what is Freemasonry? Well, we're one of the world's largest and oldest fraternal charitable organisations. We're non-political, and more to the point, we're non-religious. Despite what you might have heard about us, we don't sacrifice chickens in the building, we don't read the entrails of sheep. Far from it, in fact. One of the requirements of being a Freemason is you must believe in a supreme being. Now, that can be Allah, Buddha, it can be the Christian God. Basically, what I'm saying to you is, whatever is your faith, it's your faith. We're not going to alter that in any way, shape or form. We do not carry out religious ceremonies in this building. Now, modern Freemasonry, as we know today, was formed in 1717. On the 24th of June, 1717, four London lodges, now they called themselves the Premiers or Moderns, went down the pub, in this case it's the Goose and Gridiron Tavern, at the back of St Paul's Cathedral in St Paul's Churchyard. And over a few pints of beer, they decided to form a Grand Lodge and appoint a Grand Master. However, in 1751, a rival group then set themselves up, mostly led by Irish Masons. Now they called themselves the Ancients or Atholls. And over the years they argued amongst themselves, our ritual's far better than your ritual, why don't you join us? They even came to blows on a couple of occasions. But eventually, in 1813, we managed to get the two Grandmasters together and after a lot of negotiations, we got them to sign articles of union. So we truly became a united Grand Lodge under one Grand Master. Now the articles of union are taken into every Grand Lodge meeting, and they're taken in this beautiful satchel in front of me here. On the front of the satchel, it shows the crest of United Grand Lodge, and it shows the two factions I was telling you about. On one side, you've got the three castles, the square and compass. That represents the premiers or moderns. Whilst on the other side, you've got man, the eagle, the oxen, and the lion, representing the ancients or adults. Now, our motto is Adai Vide Tache, which basically means hear, see, but be silent. Now, we also take into every Grand Lodge meeting this beautiful sword here. Now this sword has actually tasted blood. It was found over the body of King Gustav Adolphus of Sweden at the Battle of Lutjens in 1632. We acquired the sword and had a special scabbard made for it with various Masonic symbols on it. The other lovely sword you can see in display cabinet, now this is a really heavy sword. This is called a flambard. Got the flambard blade, the flaming blade. This is specially designed to cut through chain mail. And it really does chop swords right through the chain mail. This is carried by Holy Royal Arts Chapter, which is another division of Freemasonry. Now, along with the satchel and the sword, the banner of our Grand Master goes in. Now, our Grand Master is His Royal Highness, Prince Edward, the Duke of Kent. Now, his banner is actually up here on the left. If you take a look up here to there, there's his banner there. Now, as you can see, it's a royal standard, because he is the first cousin to Her Majesty the Queen. But there are two differences in this standard that make it unique to the Royal Highness of Duke of Kent. There are three blue anchors and two red crosses, making it unique to His Royal Highness. All the other banners you can see around the museum here are past Grand Masters. There's actually a lovely picture here of the sword bearer going in, the banners going in, the Grand Master and the Grand Officers lining up on either side. Now, a common thing about them all is they're all wearing aprons and collars. Yes, we here at Freemasons all wear aprons. Now this actually dates back to the stonemasons in the Middle Ages. When they were working on monuments like, say, Westminster Abbey, to protect themselves from the shards of stone as they were chipping away at the stone, they would wear aprons. They'd also have collars around the neck. Now the collars we wear have got a jewel on the end, which shows what office you hold within the lodge. Their collars, well, they really doubled as a hard hat, because you take the collar, wrap it round your head, and it protects your head from the shards of stone. Now they are what we call operative masons, because they actually worked in stone. We are speculative. In other words, we apply the tools of stonemasonry to our models. So the square is the square compound, the level steps, and the plumb rule, upright continuous. As I said at the beginning, we're purely fraternity, charitable fraternity. Now those of you came along here today expecting me to show you documents dating back to the Old Testament. Little hidden passages with treasures at the end. I get it, you've been reading by email and telegraph. Rubbish. The only secrets of Masonry, well you've probably heard about them already, the funny handshakes. When we meet a fellow brother, we will offer a hand. They will take our hand in a certain way. We will give them a word, a token, only known to a brother Mason. Those are the secrets of Masonry. Otherwise, everything is on show. They'll be on the show. Now the Grand Officers have got to prepare for their meeting, so they go into what is called their robing room. This is where they will put on their aprons, their collars, their jewels on their left breast, and then they go and line up in a processional corridor awaiting arrival of the Grand Master. That's where I'm going to take you now, through the robing room into the processional corridor. Please come join me this way. Hey, how is this?
Hello there.
How is that?
Yeah. Oh,
yeah. If I can actually come down this floor design.
Yeah.
I want to talk a little bit about the building. This floor design is an integral part of the building. No matter where you go in the building, you'll see this floor design. It is not Masonic. It's not Masonic at all. It is purely part of the Art Deco design to the building. You see, we are a Grade 2 star listed Art Deco building. The only thing Masonic about this floor design is the dark blue, the light blue and the gold that features on some of our regalia. All Masonic symbolism you'll see in this building, whether you've got walls, in the windows, it's a young ceiling, you'll see the five-pointed star up there. There's a rose England as well. The corner plenty going all the way around. Occasionally you'll see the square and compasses. That's where the Masonic symbol is, on the walls, on the windows, and the ceiling. And instead, what I'm talking about walls, look at this beautiful wood. It's lovely, isn't it? This is Tasmanian blackfoot. What happened was the people of Tasmania cut down their forests to make way for agriculture. And in cutting down the forest, they didn't replant. So this is actually endangered wood. We are the only building in the country to have Tasmanian blackfoot. And we've got 60 foot long corridor. Now this building is unique. It was completed in 1933. Believe it or not, it only took 6 years to build, just 6 years to build. The firm of architects designed it, Ashley and Winter Newman, actually went over to America, to Chicago and New York. They wanted to study the skyscrapers. Because, ladies and gentlemen, this is the very first steel structure building in London. We're a totally steel structure building. We have three floors above us and three below. And the girders of this building actually come 80 foot below the sub-basement of this building. Very strong foundation. It's got to be a strong foundation because during the Roman period, the whole of this area was just marshland. And of course, London is built from chalk and clay anyway, so it's not a very strong foundation to start with. Now, on Grand Lodge days, what will happen is the Grand Officers will come out of the waiting room, they will line up on the side of the corridor. The next person out is the sword bearer. Now, he will stand just there. Then the standard bearer will come out and he will stand there. The only person missing now is the Grand Master himself, the Duke of Kent. Now he's got his own robe that he prepares. He's even got a kettle in there to make a cup of tea. Here's his robe in the back. He's marked private, is very private. I've only ever been in there once and then security kicked me out, so I can't take him to that. Now he will come out from the robe room and he'll come and stand in the very centre of the floor design, looking along the corridor at the Grand Officer's line up on the side. They will then stand to attention. They give him what is called a court bow, so they just nod their head forward. He will acknowledge it by nodding his head forward. Then, led by the sword bearer, they will proceed along the corridor. Now, on that particular occasion, this end of the corridor will be in semi-darkness. And as you go along the corridor, it will light up and light up and light up. This is what we call the path of enlightenment. It's the path we will follow. When you come into this world, experience, you've got no knowledge, you've got no wisdom. Your life's journey is seeking enlightenment, knowledge and wisdom. That's exactly what it is, seeking enlightenment. Now I'm going to take you along the corridor to the shrine at the very front of the building. We're going to be passing the doors of the Grand Temple on the way, but I will be coming back to those and give you plenty of opportunity to take photos of it and talking in a lot of detail about those doors. But for a moment, come along the corridor, come to the very front of the building. As we go along, be enlightened, look at the windows and the ceiling and the sonic symbolism. Of course, you've got this lovely art deco lighting down the centre. So please follow me to the front of the building. Freemasons Hall. It's actually got another name. is called the Masonic Peace Memorial. It's dedicated as Masons who lost their lives during the First World War, 1914-18. 3,500 brethren lost their lives during the war. The names of those brethren are a rolling scroll inside a big bronze casket. It really is a lovely casket, isn't it? Designed by a man called Walter Gilbert, who himself was a Mason. It's rather unusual in its design. Look at the panels on the front. You've got the flora and fauna of the battlefields where they lost their lives during the First World War. And then on each corner, you've had two angels. The angels are holding trumpets, a heralding arrival of brethren to heaven from their labours. Also on the front, we have Moses, the lawgiver, with the tablets of the Lord in his hand. Then we have Joshua, the warrior priest, with the sun and the moon in his hand. The wisest man ever was King Solomon of Israel. He is represented here. The sacrifice they made for their country, for England, is represented by our patron saint, St. George. Constantly watched over by their companions in arms. So you have the Royal Marines. You have the army. You have the Royal Flying Corps, later become the RAF. And the Royal Navy themselves, keeping constant vigil. The other unusual thing about this casket is if you take a look at the bottom, you'll see it's a bow. You can see it's an Egyptian style boats. What he's doing is he's travelling over the sea of life, but he's caught in reeds. Journey's end. They can go no further. They sacrificed everything to their country. Journey's end. This is the third building to be on the site. We actually acquired the site in the early 1700s. It cost us £3,935. Now in today's terms, this 2.5 acre site will be worth somewhere around the region about £93 million. Of course the building itself is priceless, but when it was built in 1933 it cost just over £1 million. How do we raise money for that? Well, our then Grand Master, the Duke of Connaught, Arthur, the younger son of Queen Victoria, launched what we call the £1 million Fund. Now in launching the fund he wrote to every individual lodge. Ask for a contribution from those lodge members of 10 guineas towards the building of this building. All the lodges responded. Now the names of those lodges with their lodge numbers are recorded on the walls. If you look around the walls of Freemasons Hall, you'll see the names of lodges with their lodge numbers. We've actually got more money than we have. Should we get money left over? So we have a special jewel box. Now the jewel is a couple of stone jewel. We'll have the name of the master lodge different times. I've been happy enough in my son career to wear it twice in two of the lodges I've served. The jewel is based upon the window. If you look at the window, there is the Angel of Peace, 1914-18, of which he's holding the hand. He's holding the building. Now the tower of the building is directly above my head. You'll see an example of all stone jewel when we get back to the library museum a little later on. Now the other thing about this building is it's fairly expensive to maintain, as you can imagine. How do we maintain it? Well, there are actually two methods. Firstly, every time I pay my annual subscription, part of my subscription goes towards the upkeep of this building. The other thing is we let this building out for special events. We are a registered film site. You are now standing in the Russian Embassy from your Russia with Love with Sean Connery. You're also standing in the hotel foyer from Die Another Day with Pierce Brosnan. And I asked you about the later James Bond film, Pierce Spectre was filmed here. With Daniel Craig running around the building, shooting everybody in the building. This is Saddam Hussein's palace from the British Army, Mark Wahlberg. Miss Marple, Poirot, were all filmed in this building. We are a major venue for London Fashion Week. I do like London Fashion Week. I've spent a lot of rather attractive half-naked things on running out and down the corridors for quite a few years. And we're suddenly into the West End. We get the premieres of the shows in the West End. The after-premiere parties tend to happen in this building. 6 months ago, we had the premiere of the new smash hit musical in London, The Motown Story. Diana Ross actually came over that premiere. She was in the building. 2 years ago, we were celebrating the 15th anniversary of that smash hit show, Mamma Mia. So at ABBA Music, going through the corridor, two members of ABBA were here, many of them. Now within this building we have some beautiful stained glass windows, as you can see, some really lovely ones. One of my favourite ones, though, is actually over here on the left. I'm going to show you this. I love the doors. From the certain point of view, explain what the nice thing is about. These beautiful windows here. All the windows in this building, incidentally, were donated by provinces and, in some cases, other countries, lodges from other countries. Now, this window in particular, first of all, you have your faith. Faith is very important to everybody. Faith is shown here by these windows in the building. These are the 6 days of creation. On the seventh day, the Lord rested. In any Masonic lodge, you have 3 principles within the lodge. You have the master of the lodge, the senior warden, and the junior warden. They are represented by particular stonemason servants of the square compound, the level, 11 steps, and the plumb, upright intentions. And when you come into this world, you're a bit rough, aren't you? There's nothing smooth about you. You've got to be worked. You've got to have knowledge. You've got to have experience. You've got to be worked. So you're a bit rough. Like a rough stone. What we call a rough ashlar. The tools are there to prepare the stone. So that as you journey through life, eventually you're worked upon. You're smooth. You're ready. The foundation of your life. The foundation of a building. So you're a smooth ashlar. With only one instrument on it, the chisel, just to fit you into place, so that you're perfect. And of course, constantly, the Creator is watching you. The hand of the Creator is showing you that. And in his hand, he told you the compasses, to keep you within rectitude of your life and actions. That to me sums up Freemasonry. Now I'm going to take you to the beautiful doors of the Grand Temple. Then we're going to go into the Grand Temple. So if you like, follow me down here to the left. Of Tutankhamun in the Valley of the Kings. Now everybody wanted a bit of Egypt. You've only got to go along Pall Mall and look at the buildings there. They've all got an Egyptian feel to them. We weren't going to be left out. So we got this stone here. Now this blue stone comes from Afghanistan. It's called lapis lazuli. Most people tend to know it as lapis lazuli. Now in ancient Egyptian terms, that stone promotes faith, faith in your God. That small stone cost us £300, but at least we got a little bit of Egypt in the building, that's the way. Now take a look at the ceiling of this first view. We've got the blue of heaven here. You've got the red shell of all the action. There's a rose in the morning corner. The corner plenty going all the way around. This beautiful Montserrat marble with the crusty imagination of the wall. We have these 4 pillars of solid Napoleonic marble. Each pillar weighs just under 5 tons. But of course the great thing about this first view are these four doors. Now these doors tell a story. The story is the building of King Solomon's temple in Jerusalem. At the entrance to the temple stood 2 pillars. The pillar on the left was called Dalas. The pillar on the right was called Jack. Carved on the pillars was all the there was fresh wine and honey wine going up the pillars. And on the very top we had 2 spherical forks. These are celestial and terrestrial. the creator. Now, we refer to him as being the great architect of the universe, but as I said at the beginning, it can be Allah, Buddha, it can be Krishna. What we've done is we've taken an ancient symbol, a Hebrew symbol, the Hebrew symbol of God, meaning the holiness of the Lord. Now, where's the name I can have from you? And I've even signed it this time. I thought, three there. Now, what's this about? Well, it's a Masonic lodge. In any Masonic lodge, you have three principles within the lodge. You have the master of the lodge, the senior, the junior. To make a perfect lodge, you must have seven. So, four master masons make up the perfect lodge. Seven days, whatever you like to make it. Seven, the perfect one. Now the building, well, first of all, the stonemasons would cut the stones from the underground quarries around Jerusalem. They would then level the stones. They would then square the stones. They would then carve the stones in a particular mark. Then they would be brought to the overseer. Now the overseer would then instruct them to leave the stones into place. Foundation of the building itself. Now, the same time, the metal walls, this is felt in bronze for the doors, for the screens, for the stairs. It matches great paths. The hot bond in bronze would be brought into plain walls to be taken to the temple. Hiram, king of Tyre, gave cedar wood from the woods of northern Lebanon. Same one way we live. That's bagpipes. Once the wood was offered for the vessel, then the place of the bagpipes would be taken under ceremony into the temple. Now, the women of Persia were busy working away their leaves. They were weaving a tapestry to adorn the temple itself. Now, the gold, the silver, the precious stones are brought in from Egypt and Sodom. Then one might remember, very perilous journey, 500 miles across the open desert. The way to come in is to load the gold and silver onto the backs of camels and bring it to the temple mount. The temple is now complete. No, it's not. This is a temple in adoration to God. So the Word of God has come. Now the Word of God is the Ark of the Covenant. The Ark of the Covenant comes in, the laws of God gave to Moses to give to the people. All the musicians and the priests in the temples, because the temple is finally dedicated. Now these doors are beautiful. These doors actually were designed by Dr. Gilbert when he designed the shrine. Each door weighs 1.5 ton, about the same weight as the medium sized locomotive. Each door is 12 high, is 4 foot across, is just under 4 inches in length. Solid bronze, right? How do we have it? All you've got to do, first of all, is to break the seal on the door. So you just break the seal on the door, seal it up. To open the door, you just need one finger. Just one finger. Place your finger in the middle there, and just push. I'll just do 1.25 ton with just one finger. So perfect balance for 5 minutes. That's what it takes, one finger. Come and join me now on the ground table. This is the back. Please take a seat here to left and explain the temple. Right, so here we are in the Grand Temple. Now, first of all, let me just explain one thing. I'm going to refer to this as being a Grand Temple. Please do not think of this as a temple of worship. For the simple reason, we don't carry out religious ceremonies. This is a temple of learning. Of moral learning, moral rectitude. We only use this temple around 35 times a year, that's all. We don't hold lodge meetings in here. For a simple reason, we have 25 lodge rooms throughout the building. That's where over 1,000 lodges a year will meet in those 25 lodge rooms. The temple itself is actually 121 feet in length. It's 90 foot in width. And it's 62 feet from the floor where I'm standing to the heavens above. There we have the heavens above. So that star in the centre. Now that star there is the North Star, the guiding star. Constant star on the unmoving star. Around it we have this box. Now, aren't you so beautiful? It's also practical. Because that is the heating and ventilation of the temple. You see, the cold air comes in, all the hot air in winter, it circulates around the room, and then all the stale air is taken out through the vents, along with the seats, all the way down to the temple. So it's constantly circulating. The temple itself is not laid up as it normally would be for a normal craft Freemasonry meeting. This is laid out for what we call Holy Royal Arch Chapter. Now normally, the 12 banners around the room here wouldn't be here. This in the centre wouldn't be here. Yes, you'd have the three thrones up there. The one in the centre is for the Grand Master himself. The pedestal would be brought in front, so you've got something to lean on. But there'd be two other chairs and two other pedestals in the room. The chairs would be very similar to that chair over there up on the right. One chair would be there in the west for the senior wall. The other one there in the south for the junior wall. Positioning is very important. That is true east, true west, and true south. There's only one way I can really explain why they're placed in that position, and that's by this beautiful cove in around the sea. There's nothing. That is all mosaic tiles. All mosaic tiles. Those tiles are actually no bigger than my thumb now. It took two Italian artists 4 years to design, construct, 22 months to actually place it up there. There is not a single drop of paint up there. Not a single drop of paint. Now, position. Or as I said, the master sits here in the east. The master dispenses wisdom and knowledge throughout the lodge. Wisdom is shown by two pillars. These two pillars here are the Ionic Horn of Architecture, the pillars of wisdom. You have the wisdom of Solomon, King of Israel, and you've got Hiram, King of Tyre, who is responsible for the building of King Solomon's temple 1,004 years before the birth of Christ. In the centre, we have once again the Ark of the Covenant. Behind it, there's Jacob's ladder. There's Jacob's ladder leading up to the And you might say, shown by the Hebrew symbol, Yod, holiness of the Lord. Leaning against the ladder, we have this book. Now that book we refer to as being the volume of the sacred law. That can be the Torah, it can be the Quran, it can be the Holy Bible. It is your faith, that's your book. Also on Jacob's ladder, we have the cross, the anchor, the golden heart. Well, put them away. Faith, hope, and charity. Three principles we hold dear in Masonry. So we have knowledge and wisdom. Now we need a bit of strength. Now strength is shown in the west by the senior wall. Strength is shown by those two columns there. Those columns there are the Doric wall of architecture. Strongest columns you're finding out. We have Euclid and Pythagoras. Now Pythagoras came up with a mathematical theorem, which was recorded in a book by Euclid. The theorem was called the 47th proposition. Don't know if you remember it from school. The square on the hypotenuse of the right angle triangle is equal to the sum of the square on the opposite two sides. Or a square plus b square equals c square. Now the theorem is shown in its geometric form. If you look in the centre there, there's a geometric symbol of the 47th proposition, a perfect theorem. This symbol is used on the collar of the immediate past master. Once you come out of the chair as master of the lodge, you become an IPM, an immediate past master. So you get a collar with that specific jewel on the end, the 47th proposition. Above it we have the sun and the moon. The sun becoming the day, the moon becoming the night. In serpent and southern men, we have the serpent wisdom. But he's eating his own tail. What he's doing is he's showing a continuity of life, the circle of life. We're all born, we all die. So of knowledge and wisdom, we don't have strength, but now we need beauty. We always need beauty. Now beauty is shown in itself by the junior warden. Now I must tell you, in the 22 years I've been a Mason, I've yet to find a beautiful looking junior warden. Especially one we've got. The beauty is shown by these two columns here. Those columns there are the Corinthian order of architecture. The most beautiful columns you'll find. Yeah, the all-seeing eye of God. Oh, God is constantly watching us. He's judging us in our words, in our actions. We must give an account of our life. We're in the south. It's midday. So the sun is at a height. The rays of the sun shine down. They give life to earth below. The sun is represented by the Greek god Helios, driving the sun tail across heaven, east to west. In the centre there of this star. Now, some people look at that star and say, ah, that's the Star of David. No, it's not. It's the Seal of Solomon. Well, it's neither. The Star of David and the Seal of Solomon have got 6 points. That, as you can see, has only got 5 points. It's what we call the 5 points of fellowship in Freemasonry. Or as Leonardo da Vinci put it, is man. Man himself, the truth in man. You have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Man, the truth in man. We've also on the ceiling got 4 of the 5 cardinal virtues. The fifth one you won't find here. The fifth one is very important to us. The fifth one is charity. Charity is very important. You'll find charity in every room throughout the building except for the temple. The 4 we have got, but they're all written in Latin. Let's start in the northeast corner. There's justice. We're the scales of justice in there. Okay. Here we have fortitude. And then finally, prudence. 4 of the 5 cardinal virtues. But, I don't know who's twisting your neck around, but take a look at this. Look, she's got a blindfold. Why? Under English law, justice must be seen to be done. She's never got a blindfold. Yeah, in America and someplace in the continent, she is blindfolded. But not under English law. Justice must be seen to be done. She must have all the senses. If you go to the Central Criminal Court, Old Bailey, above the dome, you'll see justice standing with a sword in one hand, the scales in the other. She's got no blindfold. Got to have all the senses. One stupid mistake they made. The other stupid mistake they made is beneath the 4 cardinal virtues, you've got the 12 signs of the zodiac. Those are the 12 signs of the zodiac. Now the big question is why? Masonically it's not part of our symbolism. Not part of our symbolism at all. All they did was they copied a design from the old Victorian building that used to be on the side. They thought it looked pretty, so they stuck it up on the wall without asking anybody. When it was pointed out to them, they said, ah, it represents the 12 tribes of Israel. Rubbish. Here's the 12 tribes of Israel around the road. Look nothing like the signs of the zodiac. I don't know why they didn't just hold their hands up and say we made a mistake. I keep pacing backwards forwards on this floor covering. Now you've seen this floor covering before, haven't you? You've seen it in churches and cathedrals. Some people say there are 3 meanings behind this floor covering. First of all, it's the fight of good over evil. Constant fight of good over evil. Other people say that when you came into King Solomon's temple, you passed the 2 pillars, and when you came into the temple, you looked ahead of you, there was a checkered pavement in front of you. Then went up to the east, you went up the winding staircase to the Sanctum Sanctorium, the Holy of Holies, where the Ark of the Covenant's kept. What a fraud design says. I personally like to think of one here, Masonically, from your point of view, that this is your life. Your life is checkered, isn't it? There's always the good times, there's always the bad times. There's always the 2 opposites, the yin, the yang. When I was made an entered apprentice Freemason, I stood just here. The master then said, face the east. I turned around and faced the east. He then said, take 1 step forward your left foot, which I did. So I arrived at the edge of the carpet. After a short Masonic prayer, a few questions and answers, he then instructed, advance to the east in due form. I got absolutely no idea what he was talking about. None whatsoever. Two of my brethren came forward. They took my hand. They helped me on my Masonic journey from dark to light, from joy to sorrow, from ignorance to understanding. The journey must all take in life to eventual enlightenment. We can go out and serve the community. Simple as that. Here at Freemasons Hall, well, any Freemasons love their music. We do love our music. Pieces of music, especially Renfrew's, the magic flute, for example. Especially Renfrew's. Well, in Grand Temple, no difference. We've got this beautiful organ at the back. Lovely organ there. It's a Willis organ. It's got three levels of keyboard. It's got 32-foot pedals. It's just been refurbished. First time since it was placed there in 1933. While it was away being refurbished, we took advantage of the fact and we had this cage built at the back. Now that cage contains, believe it or not, 400 organ pipes. Yeah, 400 organ pipes. Some of those pipes are no bigger than my laser pen. Once they completed it, then we got Robert, our gilder, to come in. And Robert gilded it in 23-carat gold leaf. When he completed it, when we realised we made a mistake. Because that was gleaming like it is today, but everything else in the temple looked horrible. It looked really dull. So we had to get Robert, our gilder, back again to re-gild around the green marble doors, all the original organ pipes and speakers, and all the furniture as well. So a job that should have taken 2 months to complete ended up taking 10 months to complete and spent damn sight more money. It was well worth it.
Where is the keyboard?
Sorry?
Physically, where's the keyboard?
It's the other side. That's the organ case.
Oh, okay.
The keyboard's on the other side.
Right.
Now, I've been prattling on for a while. You've probably got fed up with the sound of my voice. You've probably got some questions, and I'm sure you want to have a wander around and take some photos. But first of all, before I take any questions from you, I've got one question I must ask of you. Now, would anybody like to hazard a guess as to how many people you can get into this temple seated? Seated, mind you. Bearing in mind you've got three balconies for visitors. All this area here for visitors. Either side of me, this is where the past Grand Officers and the brethren receiving honours will sit. Current Grand Officers will sit there behind the thrones. How many? Give us another stat. How many do you reckon? 1,500 was that? I got a bid of 1,500. Any advance on 1,500? No. Oh, I'll put your hand past it. You're quite near. 1,721. Yeah, 1,721. But I tell you what, I would have accepted 2,000. For the simple reason, the last but one quarterly communications meeting, the Grand Master brought forward two major proposals. Everybody wanted to hear it. They were queuing up outside the door. So we hurriedly got on the phone to our porters and said, bring up some extra seating. Well, they brought up extra seating, and we managed to squeeze 2,000 in this room. I, for some reason or other, was allocated a seat right at the back in the corner next to a speaker that didn't work. So from here, I'll see a damn thing. That's the end of the draw. I made sure at the next meeting, right down here at the front. Has anybody got any questions? Any questions at all? No, I've struck you all down.
So I think you mentioned a number of individual lodge meetings would be in other rooms.
Yes, yes. There are 25 lodge rooms throughout this building,
right.
And that's where 1,000 lodges will meet. Both craft masonry and also Holy Royal Arts chapters, or two of those rooms, are permanently laid out as temples at the moment for Royal Arts chapters.
Do other lodges meet at other places?
Oh yeah. This is this mostly London lodges that will meet here. As far as the provinces are concerned, like Surrey, Devon, Cornwall, Sussex, they got their own Grand Lodges. They all report to our Grand Master, which Royal Highness of the UK. But they sometimes hold their meetings when in here. This is why the room's laid out as it is at the moment, because the provincial Grand Chapter of Essex were meeting here in last week, middle of last week. So it's still laid up from that meeting. We've got Surrey meeting here very shortly, so they'll be meeting here.
not before Grand Lodge, which will meet next Wednesday. So we'll be hearing next Wednesday. I'll tell you what, before
how many, how many members?
Members? Difficult. It varies considerably. We're probably looking at about just under 500,000 English and Welsh Freemasons. And then about 150,000 women Masons as well within the country. But it's spread all over the world, of course, right from England. Right, you want to take some photos? Have a little wander around, take your photos. I would ask you though, don't sit on the thrones, because Grand Lodge really get upset when you sit on the throne. But have a little wander around, stand next to the throne car wings, have a wander around. And then perhaps when you finish, just come and join me back at the door. There's a couple of things I want to show you on the door.
Staying above it, I'm staying like it's a bit. Really hard to see from here, but if I zoom in, you see all the tiles.
I do.
That's incredibly good work.
Give me a picture.
Look at that tile work. Okay. Then you go up.
I can stay down here. That's bad. Can you see it? I can't see. My God, I can't get to update my glasses.
I got it.
Come at their feet. They're on holy ground. You can't walk on holy ground. Two to fly with, and two to cover their face. Well, in the presence of the Creator, you can't look on the face of the Creator. You must humble yourself and cover your eyes. The division between heaven and earthly functions was shown by the starry girdle of purity. There's the starry girdle of purity. Of course, in heaven, you have the Creator. Well, we've got his hands. In one hand, he's holding the soul of man. In his other hand, he's holding the scales to judge man's worth. The other strange thing about the doors is, take a look at the door handles. They're swords. But, I know you can't see it in this light, but let me assure you, the point of the sword is actually embedded into the bronze. We're at peace. We don't need the swords. Thanks to the sacrifice that those men made during the First World War, the swords are no longer needed. We're at peace. Now, the other thing, gentlemen, I've been talking a lot about King Solomon's Temple. Why do I talk about King Solomon's Temple? Well, this is a building that was built 3,000 years ago. Just imagine, 3,000 years ago, they built a five-story building of solid marble, architecturally perfect. The architect who designed it was a man called Hiram Abiff. Hiram Abiff represents beauty. Here he is on the door, holding the plans of the building in his hands. But of course his vision would not have come about without the labour of the stonemasons. Here is represented the stonemasons. In his hand he's holding the two major instruments of stonemasonry, the square and compass. He represents labour, Hiram, his beauty. Now that's it. Thanks for joining us. I hope you enjoyed the tour. I'm going to take you back towards the Library Museum by a slightly different route. I know some of you have seen the exhibition of 300 years of English Freemasonry. Next year in June, we're all going to Royal Albert Hall, have a good old celebration, nice old booze up afterwards, no doubt, to celebrate 300 years of English Masonry, and also the 50th anniversary of the Duke of Kent being our Grand Master, a double celebration next year. So we've got that nice exhibition there. When you go in there, you'll see the regalia of Winston Churchill, his apron. I don't know if you're aware, Winston Churchill was a Mason. You'll see if you can get in there. Thanks a lot for joining us. If I could ask you to wait outside the doors of the temple, as soon as everybody's out, then I can close the doors. And as I say, I'll take you back by a slightly different route. Slightly different route. Right. Right. Right, we can close the doors of the temple. Now, actually, it's only one way you can close the doors of the temple. That means it's closed. Come and join us.
Something from the shop.
On the ground floor, we'll get out of it.
Right. You're there.
Later.